Hi everyone, good afternoon. It's very nice to see you all and welcome our speaker, Dr. Rubin. I am here today because, not because I'm a medical staff president or we're here to talk about ER and internal medicine working well together, nor are we talking about your well-being, although that's one of my favorite topics. I want to share a story with you before I present Dr. Rubin. There was a 20-year-old competitive hockey player in the University of Chicago hospital room having received multiple transfusions over the previous 2 years for his newly diagnosed IBD and a long struggle with getting his condition under control. That was my son. He was no longer a competitive hockey player because his hemoglobin just didn't stay up. And many, many physicians worked to try and get the condition under control. Dr. Rubin walked in and had a conversation about what's normal and what's no longer acceptable and the navigation of what you are willing to accept as a quality of life is something you guys will face every day. Your patients trying to balance the side effects of their medicines and the fears related to that and the balance of that with quality of life is something that you will face, doesn't matter what specialty or subspecialty you take. Dr. Rubin was unbelievable in my life, and I think probably one of the most impactful physicians that I have encountered. My son travels the world and scuba dives in Egypt, thanks to Armand with his wonderful recommendations. And it is my honor today to introduce Dr. Rubin, who is a professor of medicine and the chair of section of gastroenterology and hepatology with unbelievable amount of accomplishments in medical ethics, in research, in publications. He's the IBD MD, followed by 14,000 people, and the author of one of the most read IBD books. He also is someone whose name is very widely recognized as a leader in identifying the standards in care of inflammatory bowel diseases. It is with great pleasure that I introduce Dr. Rubin, although the 100 words and 2 minutes cannot do justice. But we're very thankful for you being able to join us, even though remotely.
Wow, thank you. I am truly honored. That was the nicest introduction I could ever receive, and there's nothing more rewarding than hearing about our patients doing well and helping families in need. My grandmother had Crohn's disease, and I didn't know what Crohn's disease was when I started medical school, but her doctor was at the University of Chicago. And there's a much longer story that could be its entire grand rounds about how I came into GI and what this doctor had done for my grandmother. And so in many ways, what I do day to day taking care of people with inflammatory bowel disease is paying it forward. And I'm sure that there are many physicians in training and colleagues of ours who are there that feel the same way because of the impact somebody has had on their life or on a family member's life. And so that really touched me. And so thank you very much for inviting me to talk today. I do focus on inflammatory bowel disease, and we're going to talk about one of the inflammatory bowel diseases, ulcerative colitis. And I'm going to take you through a case, which is always a nice way to do a grand rounds, and then teach you a little bit about what we're learning regarding the cause of ulcerative colitis and our approach to management. I have a bunch of disclosures. These are relevant because I work with industry to develop new therapies. And I think it's important that you know about that. But this entire presentation, this is a real patient from my practice. My comments, my slides, this is all mine and I take responsibility. So at the conclusion of my presentation, it's my hope that you will recognize the common presentation and progression of ulcerative colitis, understand the appropriate treatment options for folks who have ulcerative colitis. I'm gonna make sure that you understand and emphasize recent changes in the way we manage this condition and other chronic conditions like it. And I'm hopeful that you'll gain insight into some of the newer ideas about what's causing not just this disease, but many immune-mediated diseases around the world. So let's start with a patient. This is an 18-year-old man who presented with 4 months of rectal urgency and frequency, was waking up from sleep with his symptoms and noticing blood with bowel movements, and even had one episode of incontinence and had some nausea. there's many things about those symptoms that you would immediately understand, in part because I'm presenting to you today, but are not acceptable or not normal. But you also know that in an 18-year-old person's life, having some diarrhea or some urgency may not process immediately as something that's abnormal. And they may believe, as most would, that it's something they ate, or it's a phase they're going through, or they have a nervous stomach. A lot of different thoughts go through their mind. What often happens is they end up seeing a physician who tells them that they might have a functional bowel disorder, because statistically, that's much more likely in a young person. But the red flags here, which I hope you're picking up on, are number one, waking up from sleep with symptoms, and number two, seeing blood. And obviously incontinence is devastating for anyone. But those are the things that should always perk your ears up when somebody's describing a change in bowel habits. If they're waking up from sleep with those changes in bowel habits, it warrants an additional evaluation. This person is a senior in high school. They're feeling stress, but then again, who isn't anywhere at any point in their life these days, and has no tobacco history. There's no GI or immune problems in the family. He has a sister with type 1 diabetes and has never had any surgeries. Each one of the points I'm making here actually is relevant. We'll come back to it. On physical exam, he's thin. His abdomen reveals minimal tenderness in the left lower quadrant with some tympani on the right side of the abdomen. A careful physical exam can often tell you a bit about whether somebody's constipated or whether they have inflammation with proximal dilation of the bowel, which is what I'm hinting at here. And very importantly, and I emphasize this when I do morning report here at the University of Chicago, is that you take a careful look at their bottom. The perianal area is normal. Often people see skin tags there and they just assume that's hemorrhoids. That's not right. Skin tags on the bottom are a clue to inflammation and would suggest that this is Crohn's disease. So a careful exam of the bottom, even just looking, let alone doing a digital exam, is really critical in anyone who's having GI symptoms, so that you're thinking carefully about what to do. His hemoglobin's low, and you'll notice that his CRP is elevated and the albumin is borderline low as well. And that's an important marker that we'll talk more about. The routine stool tests are performed and are negative. And as we say in case presentations, a diagnostic test is performed. So we have a lot of different results already, but you know what test we're gonna do, a colonoscopy. This is actually a video of this patient, and you can appreciate, without being a gastroenterologist, that this is not normal. There's diffuse erythema. There's loss of the normal vascular markings, and you can appreciate even some friability of the mucosa as you're seeing this video. And this is clearly abnormal. Now, what I want to point out to you is that in the acute setting, this could be bacterial gastroenteritis. This could be a variant of Clostridioides difficile. There's nothing about this scope in and of itself in a vacuum that tells you this is a chronic problem. This is how the bowel looks when it's inflamed. And remember, the human body only has certain ways it can express itself. But the history tells us this has been going on for 4 months. And of course, the labs give it away that there's something more going on. And in fact, biopsies from this particular colon show the classic findings of chronicity. So if you remember from your pathology classes, a normal colon has crypts that are aligned like test tubes. And when there's chronic inflammation, you actually see distortion or branching of the crypts, which you can see very prominently on the left crypt here, and even a little bit based on the slice and the way the biopsy was obtained on the right. In addition to that, you can see prominent lymphocytic infiltrate, suggesting that this is both chronic and acute. And that's key. You must find chronic changes in order to think about a chronic disease. So this is ulcerative colitis. So what do we do with this individual? Well, the first thing to recognize is that you have to think about what we're going to treat to alleviate his symptoms. And then secondly, what are we going to do so we can change the natural history of the disease and keep this person well? And the general principles of approaching this condition as a chronic problem are similar to how we approach many chronic problems in medicine. So whether you are rolling your eyes and you're not that interested in GI, or not, I'm going to try to provide you with some insights into how you can approach many different chronic medical issues. It used to be that we talked about a pyramid approach to managing inflammatory bowel disease. That's gone away now. And we're much more talking about a staircase approach where you start with a different therapy. And if the patient responds, you continue it into a maintenance phase of preventing relapse over time. And if they don't respond adequately, you move up the stairs to other therapies and you kind of work your way through these. And we'll come back to the staircase as I go through the case. So in this case, that patient has what we would probably call moderately active colitis. And we treated him with aminosalicylates. That's a standard foundational therapy. That's an extract from willow tree bark. It is a derivative of aspirin, but it's not aspirin. It has no platelet effects. And the standard of care approach to someone who's acutely ill is not just to give it orally, but to deliver it rectally as a suppository or an enema, in part because, remember, I told you that sometimes people have more proximal constipation. And in fact, what happens there is the oral therapy doesn't quite get where you need it. It's believed that aminosalicylates work topically on the lining of the bowel. So by delivering additional therapy per rectum, you're going to address not just the disease where it's located, but also most of the symptoms of ulcerative colitis come from the inflamed rectum, the urgency, the inability to control the condition, and the sensation of having to go. So the increased frequency all come from that rectum. And in fact, the patient improves with this therapy, as many of our patients will do. And he does well for 3 months. And then he does what anyone does when they start to feel better. They hope it was all a bad dream, and then they stop taking their therapy. And unfortunately, with a chronic condition like ulcerative colitis, the disease comes back. And what we've learned over time, and this was a study done here at the University of Chicago by one of my dear friends, Sunanda Kane, is that when people don't take their maintenance therapy, they have a relapse. So the survival curve here shows the relapse that occurred. It's interesting to know that my colleague Susie Kane did this study in the pre-HIPAA days in many ways. And she would just call the patient's pharmacy and ask whether they were refilling their meds or not. And to the credit of our institutional review board, the ethics board here, when they approved her study, they said, okay, you can spy on your patients and find out if they're taking their meds. But at the end of the study, you need to tell them what you did so they learn from their behavior. So in addition to demonstrating people who didn't refill their meds on time, in other words, who were non-adherent, were more likely to relapse, she had her second study, which is what happens with an intervention where you say, by the way, you relapsed and I know you weren't taking your medicine. Well, as you might suspect, many patients then were more adherent to therapy. But given human behavior, many of those patients, after they became more adherent, later became non-adherent again. So one of the messages about any chronic medicine and chronic management of conditions is the importance of reminding patients why they take maintenance therapy. Why am I taking this medicine every day? And if they're in remission feeling well and they stop their medicine for a day or a week, they should still feel well because they're in remission. The whole point of maintenance therapy is to prevent relapse over time. And that's a message we emphasize. So the lesson learned from Susie's nice study is that maintenance therapy is needed and that we need to remind people why they're taking their medicines. So the patient actually goes back on his 5-ASA, but it's not really working. And at this point, the doctor decides to give him steroids. And this is a common prescription. It's the most common therapy that's added to 5-ASA. We know a lot about steroids, and they were first described in some of the earliest placebo-controlled trials in our field in the 1950s. In fact, my grandmother's Crohn's disease was in a placebo-controlled trial of ACTH to treat Crohn's disease in the 1950s. But an important part of this is that we also have learned over the years, steroids are associated with the worst outcomes in our field. The highest rate of infections, the highest rate of actually mortality in Crohn's and colitis. And we also know that patients who need steroids, who earn that next level of therapy, also need a steroid-sparing therapy to stay off steroids. And a fundamental principle of managing Crohn's and colitis is avoiding steroids. So whenever we look at outcomes of our treatments, we look at the need for steroids, the successful avoidance of steroids. And whenever we look at long-term outcomes in IBD, One of the measures is how much does that patient end up needing steroids as rescue therapy. So this patient was put on steroids right away, and they work. Steroids are very lymphocytic, as I'm sure your oncologist will tell you. And when they were introduced in ulcerative colitis, you can see they reduced the mortality dramatically. Look at that. People used to die from ulcerative colitis from significant protein wasting and loss, as well as from colons becoming toxic and rupturing. And steroids changed all of that. But when you read about the history of steroids in the field, the doctors who had insight after taking care of a lot of patients with steroids readily admit that they became so enthused by the effect of steroids that they sort of washed away and ignored the side effects of steroids. And it wasn't until years later that we got better at understanding that. So they're now, of course, avoided as much as possible, but we still use them as an inexpensive option, as an induction therapy to get people feeling better, and as a bridge to steroid-sparing maintenance therapies. So getting back to our case, we actually went on to another older therapy, thiopurines. Thiopurines were studied in Crohn's and colitis in the 1970s and 80s. And in the early days, they used a dose that was being used for treating leukemia. And they learned very quickly that that was much too high of a dose and there was too much toxicity. But then they learned a little bit more that modifying that dose could actually provide better control. Now, it's a very interesting point that thiopurines are metabolized by a genetic polymorphism called the thiopurine methyltransferase enzyme. And in fact, more recently, they've described another genetic polymorphism that's more prevalent in Asia called the NUDT15 polymorphism. Now, the reason I point this out isn't because you're all going to be experts at dosing thiopurines, but to say to you that for years, we've been trying to be more precise in how we use these therapies. And if a patient doesn't have adequate TPMT, which one out of 300 people don't have, if that's the case, then the thiopurine will cause bone marrow failure. So we actually need to know what they have and to treat them properly. But as you can see in the box there, most people have normal to high TPMT activity, and therefore most people tolerate the standard dosings of the medicine. So unfortunately, our patient doesn't respond to this therapy, and he has a flexible sigmoidoscopy to reevaluate his disease, and lo and behold, it actually looks worse. As you can see on the right there, now you can actually appreciate there's ulcers. That's what the white areas are, and exudate and spontaneous bleeding. This is at the next level of what we say is the endoscopic appearance of his colitis. And now that he's been on steroids and thiopurines, we worry about an opportunistic infection like CMV. So we do biopsies to look for that. And we look for C. diff. You don't have to be exposed to antibiotics if you have IBD to develop C. diff. And both of these infections are not present. This is unfortunately the natural history of this young man's colitis progressing. So we've learned that when patients have CMV or Clostridioides difficile infection, they are much more likely to end up with surgery of their colon. So not only is his disease getting worse, but we always want to look for those infections so that if they have them, we can treat them aggressively. And we've learned that you can have both. So we always think about this every time someone's not responding to therapy or gets admitted with a worsening of their Crohn's or colitis, standard of care dictates that you exclude these infections. So moving on to our case now, we have climbed two stairs and he's not doing well. So now we add an anti-TNF therapy. Now notice I said add. We didn't stop the thiopurine, and I'll explain why. And in ulcerative colitis, there are three anti-TNFs that are available. And when anti-TNF was developed as a treatment strategy in Crohn's and colitis, it was revolutionary. The first revolution in managing IBD was the understanding about steroids. And the second revolution that changed the world overnight was the use of anti-TNF therapy. And just an interesting bit of trivia, anti-TNF worked well in rheumatoid arthritis and it worked well in Crohn's. And people said it wasn't going to work in ulcerative colitis, but they were wrong. It works plenty well in many patients. So we added anti-TNF to his thiopurine. Well, the reason we did that is because one of the best studies we have in ulcerative colitis was this comparative effectiveness study. So I'm sure you know about comparative effectiveness. I'm sure the trainees are learning about that as well. And in this particular study of patients who were naive to therapy, it showed that patients who received combination therapy of the anti-TNF infliximab with the thiopurine did better than either of those therapies as monotherapy. And although the numbers look relatively small, this was a statistically significant result, and it definitely changed our practice. Now, if he already failed the thiopurine, why might combo therapy work better? Well, we've actually learned that when you have azathioprine in combination with infliximab, it raises the infliximab level. We don't fully understand why, but it does. And it also prevents a very important thing from happening, which is the patient doesn't develop anti-drug antibodies. And unfortunately, just like how we want people to develop antibodies against a vaccine, if you give a protein-based therapy like a monoclonal antibody, some therapies, and infliximab is one of them, will trigger antibodies. If your body develops antibodies against the infliximab, you're essentially immune to the therapy and it won't work. So we use combo therapy, at least in the beginning, to make sure we get people on therapy and stabilize them. So that's why, in my patient's case, we added infliximab to his azathioprine. So after he got the loading doses of this drug, he's feeling better. We move into maintenance phase, and he's doing great for 6 months. And unfortunately, at 6 months, we end up with the patient relapsing. And so what happened here? Well, he had probably what we would call a response to therapy, but didn't achieve deep remission, meaning he didn't get to that level where the inflammation was under control. And unfortunately, he's not doing well again. So there's lots of reasons to think about that in any field. And some of these principles apply to any disease you want to consider. Why might this be happening? One is the disease is still progressing. It's a freight train out of control. Two is that he started to feel well and he stopped his therapies or he missed his infusion of infliximab. Three, despite the fact that he was improving, he has gotten an infection that makes it harder to respond. And four is what I said, which is he responded but didn't get to that deep remission. So what we've learned about monoclonal antibodies, as much as the revolution of anti-TNF therapies changed our world, we also very rapidly needed to learn a lot about how to use therapies like this in our patients. And one of the challenges is that there can be pharmacokinetic changes that occur over time. Not only anti-drug antibodies, which we can look for, but we can also see that the patient gains weight and therefore there's not enough drug to do what we need it to do. Or the last concept there, the final bullet point, mechanistic escape. And I'm going to explain what that means to you when I get to the next part of the presentation. But in other words, the mechanism just stops working and the patient's body is finding a new pathway of inflammation. So what do? Well, we assess what's going on with his drug. We find out that he has plenty of infliximab in his serum. So we know he's getting the drug and it's doing its job at some level. And he doesn't have any anti-drug antibodies, but he's sicker now. His hemoglobin is lower. His CRP is higher, his albumin is lower, and he has additional assessment for infection once again, and it's negative. So what are we going to do next? Well, we have several options, and I'm not going to take you through all of this because I'm trying to make some basic points today. One of them is an anti-integrin monoclonal antibody called vedolizumab, which targets lymphocytes that traffic to the bowel. Another one is an anti-IL-12/23 therapy, which is also excellent for psoriasis, called ustekinumab. And then we have targeted novel small molecules that are JAK inhibitors. And there's only one available currently, that's tofacitinib. And of course, at this point now, we should be thinking about whether this gentleman is going to need to have his colon removed and need surgery. So lots of things to think about. And in fact, in this particular case, we ended up moving to tofacitinib. So tofacitinib is a Janus kinase inhibitor. And what I'm showing you in this cartoon is that there are four different Janus kinase enzymes, JAKs 1, 2, and 3, and then one that's called TYK2, just to confuse us. But there's four. And tofacitinib, which is approved for the treatment of moderate to severe ulcerative colitis, actually blocks Janus kinase 1 and Janus kinase 3 and a little bit of Janus kinase 2. These enzymes are involved in activation of lymphocytes through transmembrane receptors and then the production of multiple cytokines. So this is a small molecule. That term means it can be absorbed through the lining of the gut. It's oral, and it blocks all the pathways you see on this slide. So you can appreciate that when you knock off all these different cytokines, number one, this is a powerful immune suppressant. So don't be fooled by the fact that it's just an oral therapy you take twice a day. But number two, it's going to hit broadly. So it's kind of like steroids in that regard. In addition, we know from the JAK studies that when the drug works, it works very fast. Within days, patients are already feeling better. So why did we choose a small molecule now instead of one of those other biological therapies? Well, in part because he had a low albumin, and there was thought that maybe he was just leaking protein from this very inflamed colon. So why would I give him more protein-based therapies? And in part because this mechanism is very potent and works extremely well, and it's positioned after anti-TNF. So that's the therapy we gave to him. And here's what his colon looked like literally 8 weeks after he got started on tofacitinib. So you saw the picture from his FlexSig, you saw the baseline colonoscopy video, and now this is what a normal colon should look like. Reflection of the light, you actually see blood vessels very distinctly, and obviously no ulcers or spontaneous hemorrhage. So this was a success for now. And let me teach you a little bit about what we've learned about ulcerative colitis and how we're trying to move the field forward. So first of all, we'll go back to the question of why did an 18-year-old man who was otherwise well but stressed in high school develop ulcerative colitis? Well, I ask every patient I see what their theory is about how they got the disease. But the reality is that we don't know, and most patients feel like they don't know. Most people who have inflammatory bowel disease have no family history. They have no clue how they got it. And very importantly, they can be from any racial, ethnic, or part of the world, and they can still develop these diseases. Picture on the right, by the way, is by the famous medical illustrator who was a surgeon, Dr. Frank Netter. And his pictures always tell a story. What you see there is classic ulcerative colitis, diffuse, continuous inflammation without involvement of the submucosal tissue. So the wall of the bowel is actually not involved. That's distinct from Crohn's, where you get transmural inflammation. So in IBD, this now in the United States, there's over 3 million individuals who have it, according to a CDC study. That means 1% of Americans have inflammatory bowel disease. And as you probably see on all the commercials that are running in the direct-to-consumer advertising, there are a variety of therapies available. It's divided about equally between ulcerative colitis and the other condition called Crohn's disease. Most, but not all, people are young at diagnosis. So our patient is just like what we usually see, diagnosed between ages 15 and 30, and it can be chronic. It tends to last a lifetime. Most IBD patients have no family histories. And although if you're from an Ashkenazi Jewish ancestry, you have a higher risk compared to others, you should know that it's not only Jewish people who have this. In fact, there are a minority of people who have IBD. Very interestingly, it used to be that we said that when people immigrated to the United States, their children would get IBD like the rest of the US. Now we see that when people move to the United States, within 10 years of being here, they can develop IBD like the rest of the population. So there's been an acceleration of what we believe to be environmental factors driving these diseases. There have been many theories about IBD and what causes it over the years. And some of them are recurring theories, whether this was a cancer. Well, thankfully we've learned that's not the case. Whether it's some type of infection that keeps coming up. People keep saying, where's the infectious origin or etiology of this disease? Whether it has to do with something psychogenic. I have a book on the shelf in my office that I inherited from my mentor, Dr. Kirzner, the person who took care of my grandmother. And that book is entirely about the psychogenic causes and treatment of people with colitis from the 1960s and 70s. And that's now been debunked and is not true. But it led to a whole bunch of different treatment strategies that were not effective, and a stigmatization of a personality that went with these diseases that was not earned and is not deserved. And you can see a variety of other potential causes of IBD that have been considered. In this very nice review article written by Gil Kaplan and Sue Ng from the University of Calgary and the Chinese University of Hong Kong, they describe what is happening on IBD around the world. And in fact, we're seeing a rapid rise of inflammatory bowel disease in the Asia Pacific region, in places where IBD was only case reports in the past. And it's ulcerative colitis more than Crohn's disease. And there are lots of theories about why this might be. Some of those theories have to do with it must be in the environment. Something we're doing is changing the way people respond. But this is complicated. This is a complex set of diseases, and it's probably more than just ulcerative colitis and Crohn's. When we talk about IBD, we're probably talking about 50 or 100 different diseases. And now there's over 190 single nucleotide polymorphisms that have been identified associated with Crohn's and colitis, and a variety of other microbiome studies that are going on. And very interestingly, a lot of the results of this research that are going on have an overlap between Crohn's and colitis. It's not distinct. And that's probably more confusion about how we label these diseases and how we think about them. But the underlying result is that there's immune dysregulation. So whatever combination of genetic, environmental, and microbiome factors are working together, what we see and what the patient experiences is the result of overactive inflammation. That's why our targeted therapies, for the most part, are focused on the inflammatory problem. Now, others have suggested some other potential explanations for why IBD is rising around the world. Some have said, well, maybe this is just an observational bias because we're looking, we have colonoscopies, et cetera. That's largely been debunked because there's a national health service with very good data from some parts of Asia, including Japan, that say no. The second part is ulcerative colitis is not a silent disease. When somebody has inflammation of the rectum, they're miserable and you find it quickly. So it's not like it's all been there for all this time and we're only finding it now because we're looking. The other theory is the hygiene hypothesis, that we've eliminated pathogens from our guts and from the world to the point where our body's immune systems don't know how to react properly anymore. And therefore it's not trained at the right time in adolescence or in young childhood to respond to the environment properly. So that when you reach young adulthood and your gut gets triggered by some antigen, it doesn't have the right regulatory control. So the hygiene hypothesis is very interesting, but it's not always the best explanation for what we're observing. A hidden or occult infection like Helicobacter pylori, where's the H. pylori of the colon, has been raised many times over the years. And the most plausible explanation more recently is either diet directly, like a Western diet, and there's lots of studies that show that a fatty diet leads to more inflammation, or more likely, because a lot of the diets in Asia haven't really changed in their substance, but rather how we preserve food and how we prepare food might be driving some of this. And so there's been lots of discussions. There's also been some really curious observations. Remember I told you that our 18-year-old patient had not had any surgeries? Well, I was interested in saying that to you, and I always ask about it, because there are multiple studies that have demonstrated that if you have your appendix removed before age 21, you're protected against getting ulcerative colitis. That vestigial organ called the appendix probably has a role in the immune system of our intestines that we don't fully understand. Also, diets that are high in omega-3s seem to be associated with a lower rate of IBD. And a variety of things are increased with ulcerative colitis. Diets that are high in linoleic acid, which is like red meat, certain other things. People who quit smoking develop ulcerative colitis. That's for ulcerative colitis. People who smoke are more likely to have Crohn's, and it makes Crohn's harder to treat. So it's an opposite association, and people get confused by that. But actually, in ex-smokers who have ulcerative colitis, if they start smoking again, their disease goes away. And we don't know why that is. Studies of nicotine have not been the answer. So it's complicated. I want to point this out to you. People with ulcerative colitis are usually non-smokers or ex-smokers. So the clue is somebody who's 40 who starts having rectal bleeding. The question is, when did you quit smoking? Because it's that predictive, and they're a little older than what we usually see. Now, we don't recommend smoking as an induction strategy, but it actually has been suggested, and it's something we talk about. Having an infection can set you up for getting UC, and then strongly in Crohn's and less strong but possible in UC, previous antibiotic exposure. So if you had lots of antibiotics when you were a child due to recurring tonsillitis or otitis media, you might be at higher risk for developing IBD. Now, I told you that I thought that it may be how food is preserved or prepared. There's some really intriguing data that suggests that dietary emulsifiers, which are involved in preserving food, might be resulting in breakdown of that protective mucus lining in our gut and leading to the organisms that are in the bowel getting exposed to the epithelial cells and triggering immune reactions much more often. The two emulsifiers in this particular study I'm showing you are at the bottom there. First of all, the green is mucus, and you can appreciate compared to normal colon or exposure to water in the normal colon, the mucus lining is much thicker in these images than they are in the patients who have the emulsifiers present. The red are actually organisms or pathogens. So you can appreciate that if the mucus lining is much thinner in people with emulsifier exposures, you might be triggering or exposing the gut immune system, which is really there to protect us, to more microbes that might be commensal and become pathogenic, or other ways it's triggering some other reaction. So one theory is that it's in our food chain, and it's not what you're eating, but how the food is prepared. That's a theory, but it's an interesting one. There have been many treatments that have been tried in IBD. I shared with you our modern approach in the case that we had and the success we had. But look at all the therapies that have been considered. And this goes back to the era when people would die from colitis, when they were desperate. And I call it the era of desperation. When people are dying from diseases that you don't understand, you'll try anything and you'll use whatever you can. And it may not be scientific method. But there are all these theories about whether hypnosis might treat this. They even had a small series of patients who underwent frontal lobotomies to treat their IBD, believe it or not. And then a variety of recurring themes of giving things rectally, hot water enemas, and then the historical equivalent of what we now use as fecal transplants, extracts of hog intestines, stomach and colon to try and restore whatever was missing from this diseased colon. So you can see all the things that people tried over the years. Now we have a more modern approach. This cartoon, just to orient you, at the top of the slide is the lumen of the bowel. And you can see pathogens floating around there. Then you have the epithelial cell lining. And then underneath in the subepithelial space, you can see representative cartoons of different cytokines. The blue blob on the left is a lymphocyte that gets activated. The red on the right is actually a mesenteric lymph node. And then across the bottom here is a blood vessel. So all the gray boxes are different therapies that are either available or were in development. And what people are doing is trying to use their best guesses to target different components of the immune system. Do we have a therapy that targets this cytokine or that cytokine? Or can we use a therapy that shuts off the enzymes that make many cytokines? Can we use a therapy that stops the lymphocytes from migrating out of the blood vessel into the bowel? Or can we use a therapy that stops activated lymphocytes from migrating out of the lymph nodes? Everything I just said is actually either available or in development as ways to treat ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. You'll notice that I didn't mention probiotics or fecal transplant or other things that are not immune-based, not because we're not interested in it, but because for the most part, it hasn't achieved the goals we need to control the disease or have a reliable response that we're able to use. And so we're working on it. We just finished submitting a manuscript that demonstrated some very interesting work that shows us what predicts engraftment when you do a fecal transplant. How do you know if the organisms you're giving to a patient who is sick are going to stick around to do something beneficial? And so it's very complicated. So our modern goals, you've heard me take you through them. Clarify how sick the patient is and what their prognosis might be. Induce remission, which means get rid of their symptoms, and objectively confirm it. So patient-reported outcomes in colitis are no rectal bleeding and decreased stool frequency. And now we're talking that it should also be decreased urgency. Those are symptoms. We want that to be gone. When I see a patient with colitis, I say, do you have formed stools? Are you seeing blood? Do you have urgency? Do you wake up from sleep for bowel movements? And can you pass gas without fear of leaking? All of that tells me how their rectum's functioning and where they are in the disease state. But that's symptom-based. 50 to 70% of our patients who feel well after we've treated them will still have inflammation. And if we don't address the inflammation, they're gonna relapse, like what happened, I think, in my patient. So we've now learned that you have to go to the next level, meaning that you have to prove that you've gotten objective control of their disease. After you successfully induce remission is when you shift gears to maintenance, which I've taught you means prevention of relapse. And if you do that in order, you then naturally can change the progression of the disease or change the outcomes, avoiding hospitalization, avoiding surgery when it's appropriate, avoiding disability. And very importantly, we talk about avoiding increased cost and being able to afford the care that we're delivering. And basically, I summarize the goals as, and I tell my patients this, as you already heard in my intro, I want people to feel perfect and I want it to last forever. Now, that's a goal. Can't always do it, but that's what we're trying to accomplish. So how do you assess prognosis? Well, you start by knowing, is this person going to have a high risk for colectomy or a low risk? The patient I shared with you in our case example actually was high risk. He was diagnosed under age 40. He had elevated CRP. He had a low albumin, which is a very strong prognostic marker. He required steroids. And so you could just add up those factors and know this is somebody we're going to need to be extra aggressive about to get him under control. So the way we manage ulcerative colitis is focused on that. You saw me take you through some of our different treatments. We stepped right up in the different therapies, and this is basically what we have available currently in ulcerative colitis. But what we've learned is that when you get the bowel to heal, like that last video I shared with you, the patient's much less likely to have a relapse, the patient's much less likely to have surgery. I mean, I'm sure that all makes sense to you, but the reality is it took a lot of work to prove that that's where we were trying to go as a field. And now endoscopic healing is an endpoint in our clinical trials and is part of what we do in practice. And in fact, at the University of Chicago, one of my fellows led this effort where we showed that beyond the way it looks endoscopically, if you take biopsies, it's even more predictive. And some patients, when they're in remission long enough, their biopsies completely normalize, meaning that it looks like a normal colon again. That doesn't mean they're cured from their colitis. Our follow-up studies showed that they still have a risk of relapse, but they have a lower risk of cancer, a lower risk of relapse, even than people who are otherwise just quiescent, but have chronic destruction or distortion. So we've demonstrated what essentially is histological remodeling, just like you hear about cardiac remodeling. We think that happens in the bowel when you control the disease. So I'll end with a couple slides to show you how we're moving the field forward. One is that we're now choosing therapies in colitis, not by climbing the stairs and having people get sicker, but we're being much more proactive in measuring response to therapy. And we've learned that if somebody has a low albumin, choosing a monoclonal antibody, a protein-based therapy, is probably not the right strategy for many patients. The study on the right here, which is from Amsterdam, had patients who were getting infliximab, the same therapy our case example got, and they measured the infliximab in the stool because an inflamed bowel leaks protein. They could actually detect the drug in the stool. And not surprisingly, the more drug in the stool, the less likely the patient was to respond to the therapy. It's just an exposure issue. It's kind of like trying to fill the bathtub with the drain open. You can't get enough water in. So when somebody has a low albumin, we've now learned in colitis that we're better off starting with something else. An old-fashioned drug called cyclosporin, maybe one of our newer small molecules, but let's avoid protein-based therapies in that setting, or they need surgery. And so we've started to move towards much more thoughtful approaches. And in press right now is another paper that we're part of. This is a consensus statement, but it defines the targets and it helps us move. So instead of waiting for the patient to call that they're failing the therapy or that they're doing poorly, we're actually moving towards these objective markers and using what's called treating to a target. The target in colitis are the symptoms I mentioned. We want all those gone, and the endoscopic improvement. And we don't have to look with a scope. We can use stool markers. Just like patients with diabetes measure blood sugar, we have a stool marker of inflammation. So we just mark time, give them a new therapy, recheck the stool marker at 6 weeks. If they're where we need them to go, we keep going. And if they're not, we adjust the therapy, we move to another one, and we move across our targets until we either get to where we need to be or the patient or the doctor doesn't feel comfortable moving forward otherwise, or we run out of options. But treating to a target in IBD is the newest way to approach this and to keep moving. So I'll end with the hope for the future. Look at all the therapies that are in development for ulcerative colitis and for Crohn's disease across multiple different mechanisms. And I'll point out to you at the very bottom there, we actually have a phase 2 trial of a bacterial-derived protein. That's what SIR-287 is, and some additional more thoughtful approaches to intestinal microbiota transfer, which is what we used to call fecal transplant. So it's not just about the immune mechanisms, which is what's worked the best, but we're also now thinking about ways to combine that with ways to modify the microbiome as well. So with that, I want to thank you for inviting me, and I hope I've ended in enough time for a few questions from the audience. But the next time you're seeing a young person who's complaining of GI symptoms, don't assume it's a functional bowel disorder. Think about inflammatory bowel disease. Get them diagnosed early and make sure that they're moving through the right paradigm to get them well. Thank you so much.
Dr. Rubin, Joe Kowalczyk here. Thank you for a wonderful overview of ulcerative colitis, and thank you for taking time of your day to give us a presentation. You gave us a lot of the risk factors for development of ulcerative colitis. I'm interested in looking at it from the aspect of social determinants of health, meaning looking at it from how does educational level, how does income level, how does where you live in the city impact not only the development of ulcerative colitis, but how does it impact the treatment? Because of these treatments are suddenly become very expensive compared to what they were decades ago. And if everybody had insurance, that'd be wonderful, but not everybody does. How does it overall impact the treatment of the underprivileged?
Yeah, thanks so much, Joe. It's a great question, and it's so important. I just assumed on April 1st the role of chair of the Scientific Advisory Committee for the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation nationally. And one of the platforms that I plan to enact over the next 3 years is to address access issues, both to the care people need, as well as, of course, to the therapies they need. And there are clearly healthcare disparities that I believe haven't even been adequately described in our field. And so we're aware of this. I'll start by saying to you that although this used to be labeled as a rich white person's disease, that we now know everyone is equally at risk for developing these conditions. And I'll say that what happens in terms of how they get diagnosed and managed is where the disparities start to play a role. We published a paper, this was led by one of my other fellows last year, Ajua Yeboa, who's now at Massachusetts General Hospital. But when she was here, we actually looked at patients who had two diagnostic codes, diarrhea and iron deficiency anemia. And we compared by zip code whether they got the workup that's recommended for that. So the workup essentially means rule out celiac disease, rule out inflammatory bowel disease as a potential explanation for those two symptoms and diagnostic codes. And not surprisingly, and I'm sure you know because you asked the question, people who had that who lived in the South and Southwest sides and who had poor access to care were much less likely to get the appropriate workup, let alone have the diagnosis that was going to influence their subsequent treatment. I'll also tell you that I firmly believe that the delay in care, the delay in access to therapies, or the complete lack of access to therapies because of different challenges and barriers leads to worse outcomes. Now, that may sound very obvious, but I'll tell you that when I see a patient who's been suffering from active symptoms and hasn't been able to get the therapies that we know can change outcomes, it is absolutely heartbreaking. And I think it's a critical priority for us. So I'll summarize by saying that I think that the diseases affect everyone, that you're not immune to it or at higher or lower risk, regardless of where you happen to live. But what is different is their access to diagnosis and their access to appropriate cares. One of our fellows is actually involved with the Illinois State Legislature on a drug repository program that is halfway through the Illinois legislature. And this is about how do we reuse unexpired, non-used medicines for those who may need them. So we're going to be working very hard on this, and I appreciate the question.
Thank you for answering that. Anybody else have any questions?
We have one question on Zoom from one of our second-year residents, Tommy Esposito. He asks, for patients with ulcerative colitis entering the hospital for suspected UC flare, should all patients undergo C. diff PCR and CMV testing via colonoscopy to rule out infectious causes, or only CMV testing via colonoscopy in the absence of any other precipitating factors, such as medication non-adherence?
Thanks for that, Dr. Esposito. So the standard of practice for a patient who's hospitalized for severe colitis, and it's in the new guidelines for managing ulcerative colitis that you can check out if you're interested, is that within 48 hours, they're supposed to have a flexible sigmoidoscopy. It's usually done unprepped because if they're bleeding and they have active colitis, putting them through a prep is not needed, nor is it, I think, humane. But the point of doing that is to assess the severity of their illness, but also to rule out infections. Now, although people who are on steroids are at higher risk for having CMV reactivation, we always grab biopsies there to look for it anyway, because some people can have CMV colitis without exposure to immune suppression. So I appreciate the question. When someone gets admitted, rule out C. diff, the first stool sample, schedule them or arrange for an early flexig to assess their disease and rule out CMV. The other thing we do for everyone who gets admitted with colitis, and this may sound somewhat paradoxical, and I want to point it out to y'all, is we start them on subcutaneous heparin. And that's because active inflammation in a hospital setting is well described to be associated with an eightfold increase for a venous thromboembolic complication. And so you might think, well, isn't that going to make them bleed more from their colon? It doesn't, actually. But you do need to protect them from having that complication. Actually, the surgeons do a much better job at managing that type of thing on their services that's built in, but we often forget, and gastros are not so good at it. So you should remember that is another thing to do right away when people come in.
Great. I think those are all the questions that we have from the audience in person. I don't see any other questions coming up on Zoom. So with that, I would really like to thank you a lot for your time, Dr. Rubin. This has been an incredibly insightful hour, and I know I learned a lot, and I'm sure everyone else did as well. So thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks, Chad. I really appreciate the honor. Stay safe, everyone.